I was saying to you, Sam, I was explaining to them what the significance of this particular day, of the 29th day of what.
Yeah.
And I was explaining to them, see, we just got through the 29th day of all, and now tonight, tomorrow will be the 30th day of all, and be the first of, I was explaining to them that the Rabbeinu Shalom gave the Torah to the three people. Moshe Rabbeinu went up to heaven to receive the Torah, and he stayed there for 40 days and 40 nights. And at the end of that first period, he came down. God told him to go down because they built the boat. Came down, he saw the golden calf, and he didn't want the Jewish people to be destroyed, instead established. And he punished those that had been guilty of worshiping that idol, and he went up to heaven the next day to ask God to forgive the Jewish people. And it was a long time that he had to pray to God. He had to stay up there, this time twice, 40 days and 40 nights, a period of 80 days and 80 nights. The first 40 days and 40 nights, God was angry all that time. He called, plead and pray with God that somehow it should work out, that he should forgive the Jewish people. And finally, God was decided on the 29th day of Av to forgive the Jewish people. And so he says, all right, because Moshe was talking to God, he says, all right, what can we do? He says, they made a mistake, what can we do now? And he asked God. So God said, it's impossible, the world, so I've got to give you the Torah. The reason God gives it to us in the first place. But if we don't live according to the Torah, the world won't exist. The world was created with a condition. If the Jewish people will accept the Torah and live according to the Torah, the world can continue to exist. If God forbid they don't, the world will be destroyed. There's no reason for the world to continue to exist unless the Torah is being observed. You never ask me why.
If God wanted to give the Torah to the world, you know, for the people in the world to have the Torah, why is it he waited till that time?
Hashem, no, I mean, nothing is a foolish question.
I mean,
it was the Ratzon Hashem, Chazal tell us. You've never asked me a foolish question yet. As a matter of fact, nobody has ever asked me a foolish question. All the questions are tremendously deep. First of all, God wanted first Machshava's intent was that there should be 1,000 generations without Torah, and then the Torah would be given at the end of 1,000 generations. Mankind would work themselves up so that their standards of conduct would be such that it would be fit and worthy of receiving the Torah, which is a very holy thing, and which represents the will of God, and so therefore then they would be worthy to accept the Torah. But unfortunately, or perhaps fortunately, God saw by the time he had people there that they were just messing it up. The word go, there was no such thing as waiting. If you waited until they got around to being what they should be, it's never going to happen. So he decided after 26 generations that the Torah has to be given, otherwise the world will have to be destroyed. Because it's just impossible for it to continue to exist unless there is that kind of dedication to fulfilling the will of God. I mean, there's no purpose to creation unless the will of God is being fulfilled. And so therefore, he did give it at that time. And obviously, it took some time before the Jewish people were able to really assume this responsibility. It was so easy.
Because it was 26 generations.
It was so, no, it was not. It was, no, even they had a great advantage before it was given. So they had ancestors that were great just types, and if they were the same types like their ancestors, and so it was just a question that unfortunately they had gone away. But in Egypt, all the tribes, except the tribes, there were. We have a medrash. We've learned this medrash. Listen very carefully. This is a beautiful medrash. And I will tell you the medrash here. I'll just tell it to you. It was the intent of God, when he created the world, that the Shekhinah, the divine presence of God, would be with the Tachtonim, would be here on earth. We have a heaven on earth. This was the intent of God. He lives in heaven, but his presence is here on earth also. Now, in order for the Holy One to be able to rest his presence on earth, there has to be a proper atmosphere for that. Can't just have a situation where there's not that type of a holy atmosphere. So when they started to do improper things, little by little, the divine presence of God started to go further and further away from earth. First it went to the first of heavens. There's a measure that says there are seven heavens. It finally ended up in the seventh heaven by the time Abraham. And then there's a dispute how many heavens there were. But that's what we're not getting to that at this point. This measure says like this. When Abraham Avinu came, he was such a righteous type, such a tzaddik, that his tremendous works managed to bring the Shekhinah, the divine presence of God, down from the seventh heaven closer to earth. Came his son Yitzchak, and he, by his righteousness, managed to bring it down from the sixth heaven to the fifth heaven, closer to earth. Came his grandson Yaakov Avinu, who was also tremendous, and he, by his tzidkis, his righteousness, brought it down from the heaven to the fourth heaven. Came his son Levi, who was also a great tzaddik, and he, by his righteousness, brought it to the third heaven. Came Levi's son Kohos.
Yehuda.
I'm talking about this one. This no, there was no break in that line. That's what the whole thing is, the continuity. Would you listen? We got to have continuity, that the children should follow the fathers, all serving God, and then has a tremendous.
They're all set.
I'm not disputing that. Hoss, and he was a great tzaddik, and he brought it down to the second heaven. Who was the God of Ador, the son of Kohos, and he brought it down to the first heaven. Comes Moshe Rabbeinu, and he brought it back down here. Amram was his father. The Moshe and Aaron, Miriam, they're all great tzaddikim. They all brought it down to earth. When we learn Torah, keep the Shekhinah here on earth. If we continue to learn Torah and do mitzvahs,
it's not
we
the
are,
heaven, it's still here?
It's here, right here where we're learning
because
right now
Torah
this year. Because we're learning. The Mishnah says that if you learn Torah, even one person learning Torah, it's sufficient to bring the Shekhinah right here. So we are now in the presence of Almighty God. You should understand that, and don't take this as a small little thing. This is a tremendous accomplishment that we can, by our activity, make it possible that the divine presence of God can rest and be among us. So every time we can continue learning Torah and doing mitzvahs, we are continuing the tremendous heritage that we have had all this time. So it's a tremendous and awesome responsibility. We can't go and say, because we are so far away from what we should be, therefore we shouldn't do anything. That, God forbid, is not a proper attitude. No matter how far in fact we may be away from what we should be, in fact, we are required to make our efforts. And there's nothing that speaks better than action. If I told you this and I wasn't doing this, you see that Baruch Hashem, we come here to shul, you see I learned with the Balabat Torah. That's not because of the big money I'm making here, learning Torah. It's because it's a tremendous mitzvah.
Must be the money.
Right, whatever it is. It's a tremendous, this keeps the divine presence of God in our midst. Now, what kind of a beautiful concept is that, to be able to be in close proximity to the Almighty God and have His protection at all times? As a matter of fact, in this week's measures, I think I learned with you, I compared the Torah compared to a candle, and the neshama is compared to a candle. So God said, you watch my candle, watch mine. You extinguish mine, I extinguish yours. Yeah, that puts it very clearly. You don't have to be a great scientist to figure it out. God wants of us a constant effort to serve Him. I think He's entitled to it. Since everything we have comes from Him, it doesn't make sense that we should not try to go and serve Him in the proper way. Now, I call your attention to Gemara. The Gemara in Tainis on Daf Lamed Amud Beis, there it's talking about why Yom Kippur is such an important day. Besides the fact that Yom Kippur is a day for Selicha, God is selected because Moshe Rabbeinu came down from heaven the second time with the second Ruchos, on Yom Kippur, and so it's a re-getting of the Torah again. So that's why it's like a re-getting of the Torah. Now I call your attention to the Rashi and the inner column, about 15 lines from the top. So I'm going to read you the Rashi on this, but I just explained to you afterwards, so I'll read deep. Now you'll be able to understand
it.
He gave him the other part of the Luchos, because Moshe Rabbeinu said to God, it's all right, they sinned. Now what are you going to do? Now God says, it's impossible that the world will continue to exist without Torah. So we must give them the Torah. The trouble is, as bad as we are, we're the best that's available, never. You understand? So we got the Rabbinism has a difficult time, I can see. No, I'm not going to knock it, you understand? I'm all in favor of it. So the least we can do is make a genuine effort in that direction. They were given to them the second luchos that almost, why? Now Rashi says, Shebiyud Zayin the Tamos. On the 17th day of Tamos, Moshe came down from the mountain in the beginning of luchos, and he broke the tablets, the first tablets, the Ten Commandments, that he came down from the mountain. Shebiyud Ches, and on the 18th day of Tamos, Tochin Eso Ego, he ground up the Ego Azov, Oshim, and he judged those that were sinners, intentional sinners, well, all of them are wrong, and he went up to heaven again. Nishto Hashem, he remained there, Shemunim Yom, another 80 days. Now Rashi says, for 40 days he stood and prayed to God that he did good Jewish people. See? I fell with me at Hashem. Before God, I bore him Yom 40 days, I bore him Lilo, and 40 nights. I bore him Yom, and in 40 days, Omad Kabrishono. Then he stood up like in the beginning. In other words, there were three periods of 40 days and 40 nights. Shall consider, figure it out. Meyud Zayin B'Tamuz, from the day of the 17th day of Tamuz, you will find that there are 80 days. There are 12 days left in the Jewish month of Tammuz. Chosar, it was a month that is lacking in a full complement. The Jewish calendar says that the Jewish month has either 29 days or 30 days. So the month of Tammuz has 29 days. If there was 12 days left in the month of Tammuz, Shloshim all, and there's 30 days in all, so that's why we have today was the 29th day of tomorrow, will be the 30th day of Av. A Tisha Esrim the Elo. And Elo again, it alternates. A full month, 30 days, not a full month, 29 days. Alternate that way. That's the way.
What can govern the end of one month becomes your story?
They used to have people come in and testify they saw the new moon. And there would be testimony given, and if the Beis Din accepted their testimony, they would proclaim that it would either be a full month or a shorter month. But there came some Hussein that were free thinkers and not religious, and they tried to mess up the system. And because they tried to mess the system from that point on, took other special safeguards until finally they got to a point where they did it on their cheshbon. Hillel the Second, who lived several generations after Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi, set up the way we have it today. Derech Cheshbon, he figured out, see, that we go according to the lunar calendar. So we have ordinarily the Jewish year is 12 months. Right. 12 months. But the 12 months consist of 6 months that have 30 days and 6 months that have 29 days. Now, if you're a big-time mathematician, you'll figure out 6 months, 30 days, and 6 months, 29 days, you'll come up to 354 days. Now, obviously, the solar year is 365 and one-fourth of a day in a few minutes. So that's the solar year. So you have to make up the lunar year has to correspond to the solar year, otherwise you'll get the Yom Tevim with the wrong season. So you have a leap year, I think there's seven in a 19-year cycle, where you have an extra Jewish a second Adar, and this makes it come up corresponding to this. That's what's happening here. So you have, if you come to the 12 days of Tammuz and the 30 days of Av and the 29 days of Elul, that's 71 days, the Tisha, the Tishrei, and they are the 80 days.
Well,
and the night of the fast of Yom Kippur, that completes that cheshbon of 80, and that corresponds to the night of Tammuz, the little Avi b'cheshbone that wasn't mentioned in the figuring. Not the clay, a kavar, because it's already been eliminated, b'shosh olo, from the time he went up to heaven a second time. Hashta Avi lehu, hey, Shlom, we have 80 full days, Laila v'yom, a night and a day. So Yom Kippur, on the morning of Yom Kippur, Yorah, he went down, Jehu Asorah, Tishrei, it was the 10th day of Tishrei, Osa Yom, and on that particular day, because he came down that day, and God had now forgiven the Jewish people with complete simcha, and really accepted them real back, so Nikova was fixed for Yom Kippur, for all generations to come, on Yom Kippur, to let us know that God has forgiven us. Nichom Ron, he changed his mind on the evil Asher Diber La'atos La'amol that he had spoken he might do to his people. Okay, therefore, Nikvat Tom Kippur, we fixed the fast of the Sorba Tishrei. I tell you, I learned.
If it was completely forgiven, then why does it say that the transgressions were passed on to generations later on?
Oh, God forgives the Jewish people, and he accepts them as his people, and gives them the responsibility to observe this. But that doesn't mean that because he's done that, that they are necessarily off the hook entirely. You see, a person has to be responsible. When we deal with Almighty God, he expects us to be a holy nation. Anything less than that is not proper. Now, it may seem, each one of us may assume that how can we be a holy nation? We haven't even made tzaddik yet, let alone being a holy nation. Each one of us feels that, the Gemara says, you should be a beinoni. You should consider yourself like half good and half bad. You don't consider yourself like a real good, big person. On the other hand, you shouldn't consider yourself like a very bad person. Why is this the case? It's a very simple logic. If a person, God forbid, considers himself very bad, I say, what difference does it make? I don't know now. It's just, I'm getting used, there's no more hope. On the other hand, if a person considers himself very good, I say, well, I don't have to go and do anything, because I'm good, so if I make a few mistakes, no big deal. But if we truly understand the situation, the Gemara says in the Kedushin, in the Romans, it's also the brings in you should understand something, that this is a mind-boggling concept. A person should understand that the whole world depends on their individual action. Don't make the assumption that what you do is isolated and doesn't make any difference. It makes a tremendous amount of difference. Because just like we should consider each one of us as half and half right on the borderline, we got to consider the whole world in the same situation, half and half. Therefore, we being a part of the world, if we do something that's improper, we're messing up the whole balance sheet of the whole world. What our little action. On the other hand, if we do something proper, we're making it good for the whole world. So in fact, we have an awesome responsibility. And especially since we're Jewish, we have the responsibility of living according to the Torah, which is a tremendous responsibility. And it should not be taken as something that you can ignore. Now, in relation to what I told you about the Shekhinah, if you sit and learn, we can learn on Pirkei Avos, that very concept. I want to learn with you a Mishnah in Pirkei Avos that says that very thing. You don't have to be a million people learning Torah, just one person learning Torah is enough to bring the Shekhinah here. You understand? All right, here we have four copies of the Mishnah. There's this one here, and another one. There's, you can look on with Nathaniel here. Let me see. He's got something. Oh, this would be in the third parak, wouldn't it? Actually, it's not only in Pirkei Avos, I want you to know. It is also in many Gemaras, too. But since we have Pirkei Avos in front of us, we'll learn Pirkei Avos. But I want you to know the same thing.
3-3.
Third Mishnah, the sixth Mishnah, and the third Perek, the Tariq Beis, page 183.
But then, is it Rabbi Hanina
Yeah, that's another mission. I understand, but I'm going to learn six now.
But this is, is three and six the same thing?
No. Rabbi Chalafta.
Huh?
Mishnah 6. Rabbi Chalafta Ish Kapananya Omer. You have it?
Yeah.
All right, fine. Which one is in your order?
Chalafta Begdosav Kabarachan.
No. Are you in chapter 3?
Yes.
Give it to me. I'll find it for you in a second. Oh, I see. You have a different nusach. Here in this Mishnah is the man from Kananya says, and your nusach, but it's the same gentleman. Kapar Kananya Omer, Asura, 10 Jews, Sheyoshvi, if they sit and they are learning Torah, Shneam, the divine presence of God is resting among them. How do you bring that? Shneamar, we have a Pasuk of Tehillim and Perek Beis, Elokim Nitzov Adas, the God is standing in the congregation of God. So let's look in the Bartanura on the inner column. Oh, wait. Garcina, they have a different Gersa there. The ten is sitting in judgment. But Adas, the called Adol, like a minion, a congregation, Chuso Masora. When you call the word Adol, it means nothing less than ten. Shenemar Baraglim, remember by the case of the spies? How long do I have to go and tolerate this evil congregation? That's talking of 10 spies that were giving a bad report about Eretz Yisrael. Yotsu Yeshua Bekolev, that excludes Yeshua and Kolev that gave a good report by Eretz Yisrael. Ariasaurus, so that's 10. So every time you say here, if 10 are engaged in learning Torah, what's the question?
Quotes brachas.
I find good.
Chafa Alephamid Beis. They just derive from the scripture that Ada refers to at least 10 people.
Yeah, we have a lot of Gemaras there. There's a Gemara in Megillah to it also. Let's not get into that. Let's go for it. Hamisha, what if only five? We have now, Baruch Hashem, more than five learning here now.
Mm-hmm.
How do we know, even if five are learning Torah, that the divine presence of God, the Shekhinah, is among us? See, when I tell you something, I don't want you to say that I believe you, Rabbi Friedlander. I don't want you to believe me. Believe the Chazal. They're telling it. They are the authorities. I certainly am not. And when I'm telling you that this is the case, here I'm showing it to you, in fact. Shinemar, so I'll urge you to know. This group, Huda, this group, I'll urge you to know, has a foundation on the earth. And we learn from that there are five. Actually, I think the psukim are a little mixed up. Because regardless of the psukim, because if you look at the Misho, how do we know that five? Shinemar, Bekerev Elokim Yishpot. In the midst of God, there will be judging. So what do you, if you have judging, what do you have? Shlosha, the Ayonim, you have three judges. You have two people that are contradicting one another and coming to judgment. So that makes five. You should understand one thing. You come to Beis Din, a Jewish tribe of three rabbis, and ask them to decide the question of Jewish law. In effect, what's happening is that they're learning Torah. And when they teach and tell the litigants, the plaintiff and the defendant, on their decision, they're teaching Torah to them. So in effect, you're learning Torah. When you make a decision on halacha, it's the same thing as learning Torah. And so even five, that are learning Torah also brings the divine presence of God. The Mishnah goes on to say, how do we know even if three are learning Torah, that the divine presence of God? In Emar, Bekerem, Elohim, Ishpo, in the midst of God, they will judge. And that means just judgment is made by three Dayonim. Nine Afilush Naim, how do we know even two are learning Torah, the divine presence of God, it comes in their presence. Shin Emar, all the Hebrew, Yireh Hashem, then will be speaking those that fear the Lord, Ishar Eo, a man to his fellow, that's two people, then Ishvani will hear. Why do we know even one person is sitting and learning Torah that the divine presence of God is there? Every place I shall ask you, Hashemi, that you mention my name, I will come to you and I will bless you. Now consider, every time we sit here and we learn Torah, we are being blessed by God. The Talmud Torah Keneged Kulam, the learning of Torah is the biggest mitzvah in the hall. Every time you sit and learn Torah, every time we ask questions and we learn Torah, we are engaged in the most productive of all the mitzvahs of the entire Torah. And in addition to everything else, we are successful in having the divine presence of God among us. This mission that I just learned with you is learned in other places, like for instance the one you wanted us to learn in the first place, Bezalel. The earlier Mishnah by Rabbi Hanina and yours. Actually, it's the middle of Beis. I'll start from the beginning of Beis. And if you have it, page 181. And the one we have here. The second command of the Kohanim said, was also a great gadol, pray for the peace of the government. If there wasn't the fear of the government upon the populace of the people, Chaim lo, each man would swallow up alive his fellow. You have to have a government in order to keep people from anarchy, where everybody would destroy each other. You remember those Wild West things where everybody killed everybody else? That's where there's a lack of government.
Mali is what, the government?
Mali, if there wouldn't be together, he printed several missions together. The second part is what he said. Was the father-in-law, Rabbi Meir. Omer said, two people that sit, the Ein Beinayim Dibrei Torah, and there are not between them words of Torah, Harizeh Moshe Leitim. This is like the sitting of of a place where people are scornful. They are people that are anti-Torah, anti-God. It's just like you have a tremendous mitzvah for learning Torah, you have a tremendous sin for a bitul Torah, for not learning Torah when you can. Yes.
What about if you can't, like one of the two is a great tzaddik and the other one doesn't learn Torah?
Well, then the one that can learn should teach you, but that's not proper.
What if you get upset if the guy tries to learn with him?
Well, you shouldn't be upset. The truth is, we're all beginners. I've explained it to you many times before. Baruch Hashem, I've been learning Torah on a yeshiva level for the past 43 years. But does that make me a tremendous scholar? No. I'm just a beginner. Thanks God, I can learn a little bit. And so I'm glad to share my learning with the rest of you. But I don't pretend, and I God forbid that I should even pretend that I equal any of these great Hashem. You're my son, you'll talk like that. But that's the thing, but in the real world, it's not so. In a place where people are scornful, you shouldn't sit. Don't associate with bad types. People that don't want to go and learn Torah are not the people you should associate with, because they're going to lead you away to do bad things. And who needs Torah? You haven't got enough trouble, you need God on your back, and God's going to punish you for doing bad things? That's crazy. It's much better to utilize your time to serve God, study His Torah, do His mitzvahs. Much better. The Chaim choose life, yes.
But what if severing contacts with a person who doesn't learn Torah may make a little shun because he thinks that people who learn Torah are selfish because they don't have to spend time with others?
Who said you shouldn't spend time with others?
I'm saying if the person, if the guy that he doesn't want to be with a guy who doesn't want to learn Torah. But if he goes away from
if you sit around and not talking about Torah, what are you going to talk about? You're going to talk Lashon Hara, Moshe Shemra, you're going to talk something, you're going to waste your time.
But okay, let's say there's someone who...
It means he wants to be courteous.
Yeah, if he's not courteous, he may cause a Chilul Hashem, but...
Who shouldn't be courteous? But, did I say you should? I heard somebody still.
Could I finish?
Antisocial?
If the guy will call him antisocial if he doesn't be with him, but if he's with him, he'll call him antisocial if he learns Torah with him. I don't know. Okay, so
if you give a person an opportunity to serve God, it's antisocial. What kind of a horrible thing I've been doing here? I've been teaching Torah to these people, so I'm their enemy?
No, but I'm saying it's just.
I become their enemy all of a sudden.
Yeah. And he won't have nothing to do with him then. Yeah. It means he'll go away from him.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm not telling you to antagonize anybody. You don't have to stand up. You can sit down.
Okay, listen. Let me say, if the guy leaves, the guy who doesn't want to learn Torah, he'll call to Chilul Hashem.
Why?
He may. Because the guy will think that because he's learning Torah, he may be obnoxious because he doesn't want to be with him.
I don't quite understand your logic at all. How can learning Torah and teaching Torah...
By the guy... Okay, there's two guys, okay.
Where do you find it?
Okay, there's two men.
one is learning Torah and the other one's not learning Torah?
The other one who doesn't learn Torah is on the verge of apoplexy. He doesn't want
it. Well, obviously, if you're going for away from it, you're not learning, you're going to get in trouble.
Right. Now, step two.
All right.
If the guy, he doesn't want to learn Torah at all, but so the guy who wants to learn Torah doesn't want to be with him because he doesn't want to learn Torah.
You should try to encourage people to come to Torah.
But, okay.
You treat him kindly. You try to show by power of example how a Jew should live. You try to show him that this is the proper way. It'll be good for you if you do this. It's not something I tell you to do, but I won't do. I'm doing it. I invite you to do it too. It'll be good for you. For instance, we learned tonight
bring
the divine presence of God in our presence.
But,
I mean, how wonderful that is to have God among us.
What if those very words anchor the person? I know, okay, the Tzaddik used this expression on the apokoresis, okay?
What?
And the your same words, okay?
How can you be angry on the surface going myself? I don't understand. I can't understand the logic how a person can be angry when nothing but good will come from learning
Torah. Because they don't realize it, but because they don't realize it, they don't want to realize it.
Well, that's their loss.
I know, okay. But, so this guy doesn't want to be near the apokoresis. He doesn't want to get any bad ideas, because if he tries to do nice ideas, he'll just get yelled at.
I'm afraid I'm losing you. I don't understand.
So,
are you advocating that if a person No, I don't understand.
Well, this man is sitting next to somebody that is against Torah.
The presence is one time with you. The Baal Torah says a person must be very courageous and never be shamed out of doing a mitzvah. And certainly Talmud Torah is a mitzvah. Even if other people, God forbid, don't learn Torah, you notice between Mincha and Maariv, I'm always sitting and learning Torah. Because the halacha is that you're supposed to combine the day and the night with either Tefillah or Torah, learning Torah. So I show you by example, that's what you're supposed to do. I'll give you a better example. Rabbi Chaim Kolobrocha, he was a Goan Olam in Beis Medrash LaTorah when I came there. He was an old man when I came there. And yet I saw him every day, every Shabbos, the whole Shabbos afternoon. I was learning and he was learning. Now the other Rosh Yeshiva went home. I have no tainus to them. They worked hard all week teaching Torah, so they're entitled to rest on Shabbos. But this great Gaon sat there and showed us by power of example that it's very proper and good for a Jew to spend his Shabbos learning Torah. And I, Baruch Hashem, I learned from him. That's what you're supposed to do. And so therefore I advocate to others to do likewise. This is a proper thing. God forbid, if a person doesn't understand that Nebuch, all right, so he doesn't understand, but that doesn't mean that you should be deterred or discouraged from doing the right thing.
Okay, yes. Now, this person doesn't want, if this person tries...
Which person are you talking about?
The one that's learning. If the person that's learning tries to influence him to serve God, the other guy just gets more angry. In this particular theoretical case.
No, I don't know why. Look, I've been trying to influence people ever since I can remember. Even when I was still a Talmud in the yeshiva, I was trying to influence people to learn Torah. I don't recall anybody becoming angry at me. Many people may say, well, I'm not practical, I'm not this practical, and I'm bored 200 years after the time I should be born, nobody got around angry at me because I was
this
learning.
This person he doesn't want to spend his time learning Torah, he wants to spend it doing something else.
That's his loss.
I know, okay. So this guy will get angry if someone tries to force him to do anything he doesn't want to do.
Who's forcing?
Listen, okay, but Tzaddik only wants to be Torah subjects.
So that's his loss.
If he leaves them, If the Tzaddik leaves the Russia who doesn't want to talk to Torah subjects,
yes,
the Russia will get angry at him and think he's arrogant because he...
God forbid.
I know, that's for sure. Okay.
God forbid. Wait, no, I don't quite understand logic. Why did you get angry in the first place? And he's doing mitzvahs.
Russia's thoughts are twisted a little.
Unfortunately, so if a person is meshuggah, I got to become meshuggah because he's meshuggah.
No, so what would be the thing...
No, the best thing is you have to stay away from him if God forbid he's that meshuggah, that he thinks that when you're learning Torah or you're doing mitzvahs, it's sometimes a terrible thing.
Mm-hmm.
Every Torah, there is among them words of Torah, Shechivanayim, the divine presence of God is among them. Again, the same thought. Shenemar, Yikos of Sevedik. Aim I only know two. Even if one sits, God picks for him a reward. Every time one person is sitting and learning, you learn. Yoshev, the person sitting by himself, Yodom, and he's silent, nobody else hearing him. He knows all along, he gets to find himself a great reward. There's many Gemaras that say the same thing here. Now the Gemara asks the question, Brochus, if the divine presence of God will rest with one person learning Torah, why do you have to mention the whole Megillah? 10, 5, 3, 2, you can say anybody learning Torah or any combination.
Say anybody from one and up.
I want it up. Why to mention that?
Right.
It says like this, that if a person learns, and then the divine presence of God comes before they start learning. God is like the host. And we have the vintage, the other way, you have to sit learn first, then the divine presence of God comes. And goes on to say other things, differentiation. We can learn that perhaps in the next session if you would like to learn it, about the differences between the various numbers. I think, if there's no questions, I think we'll hold this point. Okay. Are there any questions?
I mean, if two people get together, if they don't, they're
late. I'm not making that. If they miss that opportunity. Unfortunately, we don't quite have the tremendous itkis of the earlier generation. And there was a story told about one of the great Gedolim that lived in the earlier generation, that he was bugged that he had spent 3 hours in the whole year that he didn't learn Torah. And he was crying bitter tears that he had so far away that he, for 3 hours in the whole year, he didn't learn Torah. He was broken up about it.
Was he asleep?
No. So we're not there yet, where we got that tremendous degree of holiness that we consider it like that we'd be broken up about it. But unfortunately, it's unfortunate. But we have to work on it, and hopefully, if we keep on working. And everybody's learning, eventually we'll get maybe to a high degree of Kedusha, Halamaya will be. Let's start actually from the... You can't find it? That's a sign that's the halacha. The tefillah of a person...
Yeah. What does that mean?
That's a cross-reference to way in the opposite the thing. Ein mishpat ner mitzvah. Way on the end. You see that here. Look where I'm looking. Right over there. And it tells you there, if you look at Aleph, Chof Aleph, Maimoni, you're looking Rabbah, Essin Yud Tez, and also looking at Tur, and Shulchan Aruch, Aruch Chaim, Simon Tzadik, Sif Tez, you'll find that's the halacha.
All these are references.
Yes, references to the code, to the Shulchan Aruch, various codes, I just want to call the Shulchan Aruch back to the Talmud, from any part to the Gemara, and from the backwards, you know, so you can find anything you want to find about anything. If you learn, there is cross references. They have cross references where, for instance, in the Tanakh, if you want to find any Gemara that's discussing any particular pasuk, you look in Tolus Aaron. There is a parish called Tolus Aaron, you find Mikros Kedolos, and there they will give you references to every place in the Gemara and that you can find this particular pasuk. You understand? It's a simple thing of looking it up. Tanya Abba Ben Yomim says, the tefillah of a person is not heard as good as from a shul only. Actually, later on we'll find out that the tefillah is heard in our tefillah because we have a posik, and we'll offer him aleph to listen to the reno and to the tefillah. The mokum reno, in the place where you have joy, shom the tefillah, there you have prayer. Only that's in a show where people get together. Songs, yes.
Yeah.
You sing songs there, and it's usually... And how do we know, Shabbos, that the Holy Rebbe Shabbos, he is found in the shul, but that's ill. God is standing in the congregation of God. How do we know, Lassora, that 10 people should be following, that they pray? Remember we learned yesterday
about
that?
Yeah.
That's why I'm bringing it now, here. We're learning, remember the mission in the third period? We had two missionaries we learned in the third period. That we learned that 10 are Asik and
Dals.
And then we had another one with 2 and 1. Now here I am showing you, I told you yesterday that there's other places, it's another place we're talking about. So we see from here, if 10 are praying, that the Shekhinah comes among them. Therefore, we have the divine presence of God in our presence. Shemar Elokim Nito Badasel. How do we know Yoshvin Medin is free of sitting in judgment as a Bezdin? Because they're also discussing questions of Halacha. Shemar Rekev Elohim, he spoke in the midst of God, there will be judgment. Nine, how do we know Lishnayim, that's two. She Yoshvin Oskim Atorah, that he's sitting and learning Torah. Then speaks to those who fear the Lord, a man to his fellow. Yakshev Adashem, and God, and Gomorrah asked the question, Omai, Lachoshve Shemol, those that think of his name. Ravashi is one of the places that I've told this many times, and it's one of the places you find it. Choshev Odom, if a person thinks, Masos Mitzvah, to do a mitzvah, and he's honest, and he has an accident, and he can't do it. Below Osso, and he didn't do it, Makosiv Kiva Osso, God will give him credit as though he did do it. And this, not only in this Gemara, you'll find it in other Gemaras too. There's a Gemara in Kedushin that says approximately the same thing. And in Kala Rapsai, there's another Gemara that says approximately the same thing. There's many places in Shas that this concept is. If a person has, first of all, we got to talk about a person that wants to do good. And so most of his time he's trying to do the right thing. And so sometimes, God forbid, he wants to do something good and he can't do it because it's something beyond his control. God gives him credit as though he did do it. Now, that's very generous of God. You don't even have to be successful. Like I mentioned to you before, several times, that you should try to be the best person that ever lived. So if you don't make it, because you don't have the capacity or the brains or whatever it was, you still get credit as though you did, because God is generous in that area. Now we know, Shafil Echosh Yoshev Osef HaTorah, even one sitting and engaged in learning hope, that the divine presence of God is with him, Shinemar, Bechomakom, every place, Asher Azker Hashemi, to mention my name, Obo Elachu Rachticho, I will come and I will bless you. Now the next Gemara, the next part of the Gemara, is what I was discussing to you at the end of last part.
This is that quote of...
That quote of the Mishnah, yes. Okay, fine. All right, now, the Gemara asked the question, since only, even if one learns Torah, we say that the divine presence of God, the Shekhinah, comes to rest upon in that group, a trainee boy, why do we have to mention two? We just mentioned one, and we know anything of one or more will certainly be. And to the Gemara, Trey, the Kasmin, Mileo, the Sefer, as the Chronos. In two, you write, there is written in the heaven and a book of memory that these two people were sitting and learning Torah. The truth is, actually, and then the word, if only one learns, it's not written in the book of memory, but the Bali Atesra says, how can that be? The person is learning, he should get credit for it, even if he's only learning one. And so the Bali Atesra says, what does it mean? Look in the Tasters, the third Tasters, on the outer column. One, his words are not written in a book of remembrance. Clover, imacherim, with others. So, but in another book by itself, nikosvim, it is written. Yamina, like we say, all your actions are written in the book.
I don't understand what this says.
Moshe Toba. It says like this. The Gemara is trying to make a differentiation and saying, what's the difference between one learning Torah or two? In both cases, the Shekhinah is brought there when you're learning Torah. So why do you have to mention one?
Yeah,
we would also know that two, certainly.
Yeah.
It says like this. When two are mentioned, two are written in a special book in heaven, of a remembrance that these two were engaged in this great mitzvah of learning Torah. So the Gemara asked the question, and the Gemara says, but not written in this book with others. They say this, Klomer, I want to say, Im Acherim, it's not written with anybody else's record. You can have a book of records that you include the records of a lot of people together, or you can have a book of records only discussing one person. So he says like this, Bali Tesha says, you must interpret when that the Gemara says it's not written in a book of records, it cannot really mean that. You can't literally say it that way, because you must interpret it, it's not written in a book of records with the exploits of others mentioned in it. However, Sefer Lavado, but in a book by itself, because it must be have been written. Why? Ki Amin, because we learn in Pirkei Avos, Kol Ma'asecho V'Secher Nitovim. All your actions are written in a book. So everybody's good actions are written in a book.
It's not, written in a book where other things are written.
Where other dimensions. But this book,
where your book is, it's
yes, all right, fine. Because God doesn't ship anybody. Our people betray. Since we see even when two are in Venus, it comes among them. Our people betray. The third big line.
Where are we starting from?
All right, I'll start again. The second big line. Since there's only one learning, you can get the Shner. Two, certainly you have the Shner there. And in two, in the case of two, it's written in a book. The words are written in a book of remembrance. Come, the book is not written in the book of remembrance. So the Bali Tesis says that's talking about together with others. But
Sefer Ayur,
Even two. As the Shekhinah comes, tell some boy, why do we have to have three? We have to mention three. We learn no three.